What is interesting about Stephen Jones is that he teaches at a private ecclesiastical institution, and he cannot be written off as a liberal wacko. You know, I have some colleagues here at UVSC that if they gave the same lecture that he did last night, people would dismiss it out of hand. But he carries a certain degree of credibility in this community by the fact that he teaches at Brigham Young University. And that's what makes him all the more interesting given the topic. He has the highest credentials, and I have talked to other physicists. Before I organized the event, I wanted to make sure that he had credibility in the field of physics. And I talked to many different physicists, and he is considered to be a solid research scientist. The Center for the Study of Ethics doesn't want to give the podium to somebody who is going to give an argument that is not credible. And so I did my homework, and in the circles of engineering and physics, he is very well respected. And so I went ahead and organized the event. September 11th, 2001, unmistakably marks a turning point in history and has set the tone for the current political climate, both nationally and globally. The horror of that clear autumn morning will forever be burned into our collective psyche. For me and many of my generation, those born after World War II and who were too young to comprehend the significance of the Vietnam War, September 11th is perhaps, politically speaking, the defining moment. This moment is all the more significant if the public of a purportedly open society has not been given the full information regarding the collapse of the World Trade Center buildings. It may, at first glance, seem odd that an academic ethics center would invite a physicist to speak. Yet the collapse of the World Trade Center buildings illustrates a strange convergence of physics, engineering, ethics, and politics. To this end, it is my honor and great privilege to introduce Stephen E. Jones, Professor of Physics from the Department of Physics and Astronomy at Brigham Young University. His vita is too long to read, so I will just turn the time over to Dr. Jones.
Thank you. Well, let's get started. We have a lot of material to cover. In fact, I think you'll find it's like trying to get a drink out of a fire hydrant. There's just a lot of material out there. Now, even then, I can't expect that you'll be able to absorb all that, especially if it's your first time looking at this material, all that we're going to discuss tonight. So I have a handout. I hope that we had enough. There's obviously a lot of interest in this topic. It has been discussed in the Deseret News lately. Miami Herald carried an article talking about our Scholars for 9/11 Truth group, of which we have, at last count, it's around 100. It was 50 last Friday, so we've grown. And I'll talk more about that group as we go along. So at the top of this handout, there are two papers I'll refer you to. And so if you have questions, of course, I'll take questions at the end. But in addition, I'd encourage you to read these papers. That's why we write scholarly papers, is so that you can read on your own and digest and click on the websites and get some more information, look at the video clips at your leisure, and so on. Now, tonight, as we are starting I noticed that this clip here, which is the fall, the collapse of Building 7, World Trade Center 7, I might say WTC from now on instead of World Trade Center. This clip I requested to be shown on the Tucker Carlson show, and I couldn't see what others were saying, but they didn't show this clip. And it's ironic, this was the one that wouldn't play for us tonight, but now you see it, okay? So you've all seen it collapse, and as you notice, it dips in the middle, falls straight down, and very rapidly. And that's B, World Trade Center 7. Over here we have a large, as you see, a high rise in Madrid, Spain last year that burned. It was an inferno for about 24 hours. It did not collapse. And indeed, there has been no example, at least none before 9/11, 2001, where fire has caused a building to collapse completely. So this is A, but that is in fact the official explanation of the collapse of Building 7, that it was due to fire. Even, and we'll talk about this more, actually in some detail in my paper that I wrote, and it's available on the web. It's on the notes. You can read more even about the scientific arguments of why fire is very unlikely to have caused this building to collapse. You might notice the amount of smoke as we get to the building here. There's some behind. This is over at the World Trade Center, but not a lot. It's not an inferno, certainly. Now, this is a controlled demolition with explosives, different views. This is in Norway, Oslo, as I recall, and shows, again, the straight down, rapid collapse using explosives. So it's not nutty to say, let's get that straight, that this looks like it could be controlled demolition due to explosives. I hope you would agree that at least there is some comparison here that looks fairly similar between the collapse of World Trade Center 7 and this, which of course is done by explosives. Okay, now I want to back up a step or two. Let's see if this will work here. Yes, good. The outline is on your notes as well. You can see how we're doing. I'll start with the physics. I'm quite comfortable with talking about the physics. I've studied it, discussed it with many scientists and engineers in the last several months. I find it quite fascinating. We'll then talk about the highly toxic dust and so on, so you can see where we are. I want to back up one more step. The goal tonight I have in mind is to preserve constitutional law in the United States. Now, I love America, and I love the Constitution, of which Patrick Henry, George Washington, Ben Franklin, you know the list. My daughter knows the list better than I. She studied the Revolutionary War at length. These men were considered rebels. We call them patriots, but the British called them rebels because they wanted independence. They wanted freedom. They wanted certain rights, a freedom of religion, freedom of speech. We have these. And I hope we'll continue, you know, with these. So Patrick Henry in 1775 said, "We are apt to shut our eyes against a painful truth. Is this the part of wise men engaged in a great and arduous struggle for liberty? Are we disposed to be of the number of those who, having eyes, see not, and having ears, hear not? For my part," and I hope you'll join in with Patrick Henry in saying this, "for my part, whatever anguish of spirit it might cost, I am willing to know the whole truth and to know it now." Now, many of the things I'll talk about tonight, there are still questions, and I will try to clarify that, but there's an awful lot here that we have learned about 9/11 and that we need to take a look at. I maintain that we are engaged in a struggle for liberty and truth right now, and Someone, my exemplar actually said, the truth shall make you
free.
Right. So let's see if we can get some truth going, shall we? Here we go. We've looked at this. Let's go on. So here's Building 7. We'll start there, the collapse of Building 7. On the afternoon of 9/11. Now, it's important to realize that Building 7, it's here. We're looking now after the both towers have collapsed, looking from the plaza area over to Building 7. Building 7 was never hit by a plane. No plane hit Building 7. Okay, clear. Okay, good. So the towers were each hit by a plane, of course. We'll talk about them later. Building 7 was not hit by a plane. There was no jet fuel, which is a bit, we'll talk about the jet fuel as well. The fires were random but not particularly large. It's certainly not an inferno. It collapsed 7 hours after after both twin towers had fallen. It's not like it's immediate. It's not like a shock from the falling of the towers somehow made that fall, which would you'd think happen immediately. We'll talk more about that as well. The official theory is damage and fire. Now, here in this photo, you see the fires in Building 7, a close-up, and then you can see a little bit of fire in there. Not much. And yet, when it collapsed straight down into a tight rubble pile. And very curious. In fact, engineers were baffled over the collapse of this building. And myself, I didn't see it on the day of September 11th. When I first saw it, though, I thought, this is very strange. I mean, that building should collapse straight down and rapidly. It just did not look like what I'd expect from law of entropy, which is things topple over. And indeed, other scientists and engineers have worried about this mystery of the collapse of the 47-story Building 7. Experts said that no building like it, a modern steel reinforced high-rise, none had ever collapsed because of uncontrolled fire before. So they're trying to figure out what happened and worried that other buildings might have this problem around the country. See? Now, in giving this talk, by the way, there's a fair amount of material here. I'm not going to be able to read everything. I'll focus on the yellow parts, just so you know. If you're a fast reader, you can pick up the white. That's just the way the rule works here because of the time. So down here, fire and the structural damage. This is now Professor Barnett, Massachusetts. Fire and the structural damage would not explain steel members in the debris pile that appear to have been partly evaporated. Now, that takes a very high temperature to evaporate steel. We'll see how that could happen. It's not due to fire, ordinary fire. Okay, so this is now some photos. We see some photos in the late afternoon. Not a lot of fire seen here or damage. There is damage if you look close right down in this corner. The corner from the Tower 1 did cause some damage here, which would make me think that it would, if it's going to fall, it would fall towards the southwest corner. And maybe immediately, too. I mean, if you damage something, you know, knock your knees out, you start to fall, okay? But that's not the way. Instead, it came straight down. Had 24 steel beam core columns, enormous steel beams up the core, 57 perimeter columns. A student drew this. The damage was here on the corner and some damage here on a floor. Nothing severed in the core, we're quite sure. No evidence of that. So why did it fall symmetrically down if the damage is on just the south side? And why did it take 7 hours? This is a good question, I think. But as we saw in the clip, it does fall symmetrically and nearly straight down onto its own footprint. Even the FEMA report writing about this says the collapse of WTC-7 had a small debris field. The facade was pulled downward, suggesting internal failure and implosion. It's a very interesting term they use there. Implosion is the term used for controlled demolition when you pull the core and forced the building to collapse. Now, they're not talking about explosive demolition, I assure you, the FEMA. They're talking about fire. But nevertheless, they do use the word implosion. Now, over here, we have a description of how buildings are demolished using explosives. Demolishing the building so that it collapses straight down into its own footprint. This is the total area at the base of the building. This is the goal of controlled demolition. That's what they shoot for. They work real hard to set the charges so that the building will collapse straight down and rapidly. This feat requires such skill that only a handful of demolition companies in the world will attempt it, using explosives, of course. Now, if you get buildings to collapse that way using fire, you know, we should patent that, and then we'll set a few fires and watch it make a lot of money doing that. But it's not so easy. Here's what happens when you have uncontrolled collapses, okay? This is what you expect from earthquakes. In fact, these buildings were toppled by earthquakes. They fall over, they topple over, they don't fall straight down. And so, again, it's just not reasonable that Building 7 fell 7 hours after the collapse of the towers. That could not be due to seismic waves. And if it were, it would have fallen immediately and toppled to the side that was damaged. That's not the case, of course. So this is out. This is what you'd expect, though, also from uncontrolled fires, something like this. You'd expect it to topple, twist, bend, and cause much more damage than it did. By the way, the surrounding buildings didn't collapse. A number of them were damaged also. You see, I'm talking about non-WTC buildings. And so this is curious, the Building 7, about 350 feet away, that's over a football field away from the closest tower, should collapse in this way. It collapsed fast. And if you studied this video clip, I've got here second by second from my friend Jim Hoffman, WTC7.net, an excellent place to get detail, by the way, about 9/11. Jim has done a lot of research. But in timing this, and with some students, we had a number of students time this, it's 6.6 seconds to fall. And the free fall time, if you dropped an apple off the roof without any air resistance, would be 6.0 seconds. With air resistance, it works out to pretty close to the same time as the building collapsed. Now, how do you do that? You got all this material in the way. You've got this enormous steel columns, 24 of them, you know, you think, and then the concrete too, resisting the collapse, slowing it down, if it's the pancake theory that the official reports talk about. So you have, they talk about one floor hitting a stationary floor, and then that would slow the fall down. Those go together then and hit the next floor, slows her down. I did a calculation. You have to make some assumptions. It was over 10 seconds for the collapse. And I ignored the steel columns, just looking at the mass of the concrete floors and the conservation of momentum. It's looking impossible to me as I do this calculation that the official theory could be correct. It violates laws of physics, in this case, conservation of momentum. So, on the other hand, explosive demolition is very fast. You knock the material out of the way below, and the building collapses very rapidly. To many onlookers, the speed of the destruction is the most incredible aspect of an implosion. Note the word for controlled demolition. How can a building that took months and months to build and stood up to the elements for 100 years or more collapse into a pile of rubble as if it were a sand castle? Following the blast, a cloud of dust blows out around the wreckage, enveloping nearby spectators, as we observed, of course, on September 11th. Now, the 9/11 Commission report, they said that they would give the fullest possible account of the events surrounding 9/11, but they didn't even mention the collapse of Building 7. I can almost rest my case, but I'm not going to. I mean, this is really sad. It's very suspicious. And, of course, not good science to neglect data that's just so in your face there. It's so important. FEMA, do I have FEMA's quote? I think I do. But I will say just they admitted that their best hypothesis was really the only one they considered, which is fire, some damage, as they admitted it had low probability for explaining the collapse of Building 7. NIST, now this is the latest. NIST is the National Institute of Standards and Technology, another government-sponsored agency like FEMA. And at first, they decoupled their analysis, that's their word, their analysis of Building 7 from the towers study. And now, just last month, just a couple weeks ago, there was an announcement from NIST that they're asking for contractors to study and analyze the and figure out the collapse of Building 7. You could almost rest your case again, okay. So there's a good question here. What is going on that they don't just look at explosive demolition? I mean, we should consider this possibility. None of these studies looked at that seriously, at least not in writing, nothing that we have in writing. Now we're going to shift over to the towers. As you can see, a view while the towers are being constructed, you see the central core columns, 47 steel core columns. Look at the size of these columns. Huge, interconnected. I had an email from a mechanical engineer who read my paper and agrees with me, and she teaches at a major university. And she is a little worried about her job, but she said, you know, it's true. These buildings were solidly built, and this core, the way it's put together, is like a... The comparison is to a biological, like a tree. So you have this interconnected fibers. And when wind or other stress is put on this building, just like on a tree, it absorbs that stress. It picks it up. Now, the designers of this building, actually both towers, said that they were designed to withstand being hit by multiple 707, is Boeing 707 collisions. That was the big jet in those days. And as we see in the official reports, it's not the hitting the planes with the towers with the jets that caused them to collapse. That's not it. So they're talking about fire again. And I want to, I have this little, so actually this professor I referred to, Judy's her name, sent me this photo of a stove, which she shows her mechanical engineering students. And she has the temerity to talk about the collapse of these buildings in her classes on mechanical engineering. She points out that when we burn wood, and in this case it would be office materials and jet fuel too, but the jet fuel burned off very rapidly. Anyway, when we burn, organic materials, we don't expect the stove to collapse. You know, it can stand. All right. Now, and she got a laugh too. And I thought she's made a good point there. You know, I mean, you can imagine building a huge bonfire under here. Would you expect the thing just to give up? And you know, so let's look at be a little more specific though. And here we find from Professor Eager at MIT. Now he is trying to explain how the building could come down by fire, but he's laying out facts, and his factual presentation is really very helpful. The fire, he said, is the most misunderstood part of the collapse. Even today, the media report and many scientists believe that the steel melted. It is argued that the jet fuel burns very hot, especially with so much fuel present. And then he goes on, this is not true, and I've seen many other scientists, including Dr. Barnett that we quoted earlier, and Frank Gale and other scientists and engineers, saying this is not true. The temperature of the fire at WTC was not unusual, and it was definitely, most definitely, not capable of melting steel. Now, the reason is, as he goes on, the temperatures here were somewhere around 500 to 650 centigrade. Now, I'm going to use, because the numbers, the 650 is important. This 650, where is it? And at this temperature of 650, the steel loses about half its strength. But he goes on, even it with the strength halved, the steel could, and he's talking about the World Trade Center towers, could still support 2 to 3 times the stresses imposed by this 650 fire. So that's, it's not enough just with these fires. They aren't hot enough to, certainly not to melt the steel, which is at around 1500 centigrade, much hotter. And at 650, which is red hot, they would still support the structure. Now, Bazant and Zhu and other papers say 800 centigrade is what they believe is required for failure. So somewhere in that range. NIST, now in their report on the towers, they did do a report on the towers, just not on Building 7, okay? I like to say they punted on Building 7. Let the other team, the contractor, see if he can figure it out. Anyway, using metallographic analysis, NIST determined, remember this is a government lab, determined that there was no evidence that any of the samples had reached temperatures above 600. Not hot enough. And indeed, if I look closely, which I read through the paper, it's hundreds of pages. And most of it, though, is on evacuation out of the towers and that sort of thing. It's interesting, though, as they talk about the physics here. They show the temperatures, and there were some columns knocked out. Not the whole building, you understand, just on those few floors where the jets collided. It's like puncturing a screen on your mosquito netting, screen on your screen door with a pencil. It doesn't make the whole thing fail. That was what one of the experts on the tower said. He said, when the plane hits, we designed for that. It's like punching a hole through a screen door. It doesn't really hurt much, okay? But anyway, so these temperatures. And you see, we need to be up here in the yellow and orange temperatures and red to get failure, but instead, they're all down in the green and blue. It's just not hot enough. And they went through, did some tests, NIST. In their report, they point out the jet fuel was mostly consumed within the first few minutes. I keep getting people saying, well, it's the jet fuel. No. Now, of course, Building 7 wasn't hit by a jet, but even in these towers, when you look at the science, that burns up very quickly. It's not the problem. By the way, the steel has to get to 650, not just the fire. Now, these steel structures are interconnected, and that heat gets wicked away. It's called heat transport. As you heat up one piece, that heat carries over and goes through this structure. And so it's hard to heat up one area to the temperature required for failure. And indeed, they did, NIST sponsored World Trade Center tower models, floor models, testing with actual fire and actual models. Let's get this thing to fail. It wouldn't fail, okay? Oh my goodness. They can't get the temperatures high enough with fires and damage. Yeah, they can't get actual models to fail. So what are you going to, oh, by the way, my wife thought I should mention this. If you look, this is where the plane went in. I believe it's the North Tower. And in this little red box, if you can see it, there is a woman standing there, a brave woman who came to the edge, standing, holding on, admittedly. I'd be crawling. In fact, there's another person over here on, laying down. That's me. I mean, that would be me if I were. It's not me, but it would be. I'm not going to be standing up. But this is Rachel. Her last name is known. There was enough detail. She did not survive the collapse, but she did testify. It's not that hot, folks. I'm holding on here. It's not like a red-hot oven. Now, let's see what Kevin Ryan, he works at Underwriter Laboratories. He said, performing tests on the models, and this is where the tests were done at Underwriter Labs, and he said, the results of these tests indicate the building should have easily withstood the thermal stress caused by burning jet fuel and office materials. Then he goes into some detail. He's writing to a scientist. Your comments, this is to Frank Gale of NIST, suggest the steel was probably exposed to temperatures of only about 250°C, way below what's needed for failure. And that is what one would expect from a thermodynamic analysis. And then he says that temperatures are not enough. You know, can we admit this? And he says the official story just does not add up. And there are many engineers and scientists now awakening to that fact. Mine was one of the first peer-reviewed papers for some reason. And what do you think happened to Kevin Ryan writing this to NIST saying, look, we got to face the facts here. You know, the floor models did not collapse due to fire. I mean, the official story, fire and damage, it just doesn't work. We've got to face this and look at what else could have caused the collapse of these towers. What happened to Kevin Ryan? He was fired. I've been on email contact. He said it was because this letter of his went public, and because of his disclosing this glaring discrepancy. So, I don't know if I'll spend too much time on this, but how do you go? Yeah, David got the joke. So you have this equation. You know, you've got fire here. You've got damage, and then over here you got collapse. Well, how do you get from here to here? Well, some sort of miracle must have happened. This is kind of what's going on. Let me just explain briefly, because I'm looking at the clock, and I got to pace myself a little faster. So I read the NIST report. What they do is they do a computer simulation. If you can't get actual models to fail, you know, go to the computer. There's middle cases, and they're what they thought would be reasonable, less severe, middle, and more severe. Upon examination of the middle cases, it became clear that the towers would likely remain standing. So what do? You go to the severe case, and then you adjust the input. Okay. What they admitted they did, yes. You adjust the input, but you stay within the range of reality. It's good. And they talk about pulling forces on the perimeter columns by the sagging floors. The UK experts immediately jumped on that. I've read what they said. The core columns cannot pull the exterior columns, the perimeter columns, via the floor. So, you know, the NIST model is just, they're struggling here. And then as it came out in October, the final NIST report, we have structural engineers criticizing the NIST work. They say, look, quoting, the investigators at NIST are refusing to show computer visualizations of the collapse of the towers, despite calls from leading structural and fire engineers. Huh? Visualizations of collapse mechanisms are routinely used. I'm quoting from this journal. It's a well-respected journal, The New Civil Engineer. You can look it up here. And there's some detail there. Notice what the professor of structural engineering at Manchester says, Colin Bailey. NIST should really show the visualizations. Otherwise, the opportunity to correlate back to the video evidence and identify any errors in the modeling will be lost. But NIST is not doing that. Furthermore, there's now a leading U.S. structural engineer, not named. The software used by NIST has been pushed to new limits. There have been a lot of simplifications, extrapolations, and judgment calls. This does not make me want to believe the NIST report. And in my report, you can see other reasons why I don't believe that report is correct. But I'm not alone, you see, in complaining about this approach. Just looking at parts, like you have blinders on. We'll consider fire, we'll consider damage. Building 7 wasn't hit by a plane, but we'll consider fire. NIST does have a preliminary report on, and that's all they talk about there. They say, we see no evidence for explosives in Building 7. And I'm saying, open your eyes, you know, it falls straight down very rapidly. There's squibs coming off, I'll talk about those. What do you need? FEMA report. This is now another journal, Fire Engineering, January of 2002. Respected members of the fire protection engineering community are beginning to raise red flags. That's what I'm doing here. I should have brought a red flag. The structural damage from the planes and the explosive ignition of jet fuel in themselves were not enough to bring down the towers. Fire engineering has good reason to believe that the official investigation, blessed by FEMA, is a half-baked farce. Now, these are not polite terms that we usually use. Yeah. I mean, they feel very strongly about this. These are engineers saying, look, you got to do more than what you're doing. And furthermore, he goes on, a half-baked farce that may have already have been commandeered by political forces whose primary interest, to put it mildly, lie far afield of full disclosure. He said this right on the head. This is what we're seeing throughout. And there are burning questions that need answers. He's calling for an investigation. Let's see if I have him. No. Well, there's the steel beams were destroyed very rapidly after the collapse of these buildings. They were cut up. They're shipped off to Asia for recycling. And the engineers are saying, wait, we got to look at those so we can understand how fire could possibly have brought these buildings down. Instead, the evidence at the crime scene was rapidly destroyed. And this is over the objections of engineers. Okay, here's a civil engineer's comment. I just really appreciate it. This is sent to me by someone else. He's writing to someone else about reading my paper. He said, initially, I was a bit incredulous. He did not believe me. The sheer number of players that would have been involved is extraordinary. I'll come back to that. It's not true. It's a common misconception. I downloaded all the official reports, which we've been talking about, basically expecting to find holes in the good professor's hypothesis. I'm a professional civil engineer with a lot of experience in the construction of major structures, and I was just astounded, he says, at what I found. In my COO days, if my staff had put up reports like that, there is no way they would have been accepted, and I would have been asking some very tough questions, which I hope we're all starting to ask. The official reports, he concludes, are not at all convincing. That they are not is a serious worry. Take care. Yes. Okay. Now we'll talk. It is a concern. Now let me come back to this misconception, an extraordinary that is a large number of players. So if you look at controlled demolition for these large buildings, the towers, it would only take about 4,000 pounds. That sounds like a lot, 2 tons. But 10 trips by 10 men, 40 pounds each, and you've got the explosives that you need. The charge, and this is now, again, my friend Jim Hoffman talking about how this could be done. The charges could be hidden in elevator shafts set off via radio signals. The elevator shafts were right next to the core columns, you see. You get in there. And then it could even be done by foreigners. I mean, however, you have to have access to the buildings. This is a mechanical engineer at Clemson. And she started teaching. I think I'm going to have to go over this, so it's interesting. But let me just read down here. But let me emphasize that point. So it does not take a large group. There might be a dozen or 20 leaders in the know of all that's going on. The rest are just following orders, you see, in a secret combination like that. Okay, so as far as I know, she says, I'm the only person in my department that doesn't buy the official story, and this bothers me. I've approached a few others, but they've each thought I was crazy, yet were unwilling to look at the facts. Now, this is a problem I've run into. Are there any physicists here tonight? Good. Where are you from? Good for you. Thank you. So we have one. I appreciate that. And one other back here, what was that? Yeah? Good. Where are you from? Okay, good. So there's a couple of physicists. That's good. But anyway, I have the same problem. I don't notice any in my department here, although I did have a number when I was first talking about this way back in September of last year. So I can't say they were totally unwilling. But in her case, they wouldn't look at the facts. So far, I've not been called the dean's office or chair's office for covering this material. I cannot make that same statement. Okay, more. However, they were kind. They said I could go ahead with the investigation and please give academic seminars and write papers. And that's what we're doing tonight. It's okay. See, It's not that BYU is trying to shut me up, okay? I get that. That's not the case. And there are a number in my department that think that there are serious questions and that seriously doubt the official story that fire brought these buildings down. Okay, and then she says a little more. She didn't contact me last fall. I was afraid of what might happen with my career. Now I'm more afraid of what is happening with the world than I am with my career. That's admirable. We have this group, Scholars for Truth. She joined us. And those two physicists and others, you know, if you want to join us, st911.org. It's real easy to remember. Okay, now we're going to look at some, you know, we're halfway through, folks, and I'm not halfway through. So I might look at one of these collapses, but then you've seen this one. That was the one we started with. Let's look at towers for fun. These are some towers and show you. You'll see squibs. These are plumes of, double click. There we go. See the plumes coming off the side. Now, it doesn't take a lot of explosives. You pull or cut. The term demolition experts use is pulling the building. You pull these core columns, get that out of the way, the support's gone, and then gravity brings her down. Huh? It doesn't take, I had a mechanical engineer say, man, you have to have so many tons of explosives. No. You just don't understand how demolition works. It doesn't take that much. Here's another one for fun. Let's try. This one, you'll notice it dips in the middle first, and then down she comes as you pull the support. Okay, that's all it takes to bring them down, straight down onto their footprint, just like Building 7. And the towers also came down pretty much straight down. But there, the explosions were at the top. It's a little different there. You saw that coming that way. It's interesting. But it certainly could have been explosive demolition as well. Let's see. There we go. Okay. Here's the collapse of Building 7 once more. The collapse that MSNBC declined to show for some reason. I'm curious. Well, I'm sure a lot of you have looked at this before because you've started studying these issues. And this is a central issue, this collapse of Building 7. But I'm just curious, how many of you, is this your first time tonight you've seen Building 7 collapse? Well, quite a few. Cool. Okay. Craig? Kind of neat, isn't it, the way it comes down. So here's a demolition expert. And he says, this is published in The New Scientist the day after on September 12th. It looked like a classic controlled demolition. It's Mike Taylor, demolition contractors. If there's anything good about it, it's good the towers did not weaken to one side. They would have toppled onto other buildings. That's what you expect from uncontrolled demolition. You expect, you know, this again is the law of physics, law of increasing entropy or disorder. You expect it to topple over. However, the collapse of the towers mirrored the strategy used by demolition experts. In controlled demolitions, explosives are placed not just on the lowest three floors, but also at the higher floors, on several consecutive floors. The explosions at the higher floors enable the collapse to gain downward momentum as gravity pulls the full weight of the unsupported higher floors into the lower floors like a snowballing effect. It's actually pancaking, but where you've pulled the material out of the way below. It cascaded down like an implosion. There's that word again. So here you see Building 7, upper right. And let's see. We saw the squibs. Yes, we did. Remember the towers as the controlled demolition? You saw the plumes of gas and debris coming off. An explosion causes those plumes. Now, if you look here at the tower, this is one of the towers, this is the other. It doesn't matter too much which one. You see these plumes way below the area where there's destruction up here and pulverization, which is also interesting. You see these plumes, and if you look closely, there's substantial debris in there. We're hoping to get a close-up of this and see if that isn't actually a beam that's been severed and is being hurled out. But this, these plumes, and I had a civil engineer who was otherwise very skeptical of my paper, he said, that really does look suspicious, this plume coming off here.
Is there one in the middle too?
Yes.
There is one in the middle. Good eye. Yes, good eye. Okay, let's look again here. This is building 7 now. You'll see the plumes smaller, and they're going up, not down, which is significant. See how quickly they go up? Now, if it's collapsing floors, a floor making up air pressure, that should go down, not up. So this really does look like what you'd expect. And you see some in the front, too, over in this area, see, and over there. Okay, so I mean, I'm starting to get thinking. Testimony from firefighters reporting explosions, and it was on the lower level of the building, not just the upper. I'm moving along because I'm 15 minutes now behind. Okay, here's the building fire expert saying, an editor in chief of fire engineering. Look, we got to stop destroying the evidence. He's complaining about the structural steel that has been and continues to be cut up and sold for scrap. Crucial evidence that could answer many questions, which we all, or at least many of us, want to answer. Apparently some don't. But the destruction of evidence shows the astounding ignorance. This guy tends to write rather boldly. He was upset. Shows the astounding ignorance of government officials to the value of a thorough scientific investigation. He finds nothing to justify this behavior. The destruction and removal of evidence must stop immediately. And then he calls for a thorough investigation. Destroying evidence, why do they do this? This is a kind of a famous cartoon depicting what we call pathological science. The guy has two snowflakes. He's written a paper saying no two snowflakes can be alike. And then here come these two snowflakes, and he sees that they're exactly alike. So what does he do? Destroys the evidence. Yeah, you don't want to. So that's what we call pathological science. In this case, I would call it unethical because it was a crime scene. Okay, now I would like to talk about thermite. One of my favorite topics, not everybody. This is a demonstration, University in California, with thermite. The reaction is iron oxide, rust, plus aluminum, powdered aluminum, plus sulfur. Well, this didn't have sulfur, but if you put sulfur in, it cuts through steel faster. And you see the white-hot steel now. This reaches temperatures hot enough to evaporate steel. Does that sound familiar? Remember, evaporated steel was seen in the rubble pile. And this is the collapse of the North Tower. We see, just like you see here, this aluminum oxide coming off and the glowing hot metal. It looks like, we're trying to get more photos, but this looks like, this is a steel structure now from the North Tower. Something glowing there, and then this trailing off smoke coming off of that. It certainly looks like thermite, but there's more. There was molten metal found beneath both towers and Building 7. Now, the temperature, according to Eager and others, in these fires is about 650 centigrade. To melt steel requires 1,500. Thermite gets you up well past that, 2,500. And as you look at the molten stuff being pulled out of that, we have photographs and so on of this, but you see that you've got this yellow hot stuff. Now that can't be this material, metal. Now the color of the metal tells you the temperature. It's physics, independent of the metal. So this has to be something that can hold together even when it's salmon and yellow hot. Well, what is that? Structural steel can handle that, you know, lemon and salmon temperatures, no problem. Aluminum, where's aluminum? Melts at 660. If this had been aluminum, it would just be liquid. It can't be solid at those temperatures.
Now, wasn't that picture taken some weeks after
this? Yes, and it was also weeks after, thank you. And after this slag solidifies, we finally got a picture of this. You see it's covered with a red, which certainly looks like rust. Again, the end product of the thermite reaction is molten iron. And you see the entrained cement and rebar here, of course. But aluminum does not matter. I've had people say, well, it's just aluminum from the plains. Well, I'm sorry. First of all, there's molten metal beneath Building 7, and there was no plane there. Okay, so, and plus the fact, of course, we're building the evidence here. We're hoping to analyze some of this stuff and really nail it as, does it have high iron content and aluminum oxide as well? Explosive specialist, I have read your paper concerning the tower's collapse and agree military thermite, which is the type with sulfur as an accelerant to make it cut through steel much faster, is the only explanation for the molten slag found weeks after the collapse. Thermite charges used in conjunction with small linear charges. Now, I emphasize that. I believe that if thermite was used, there was also explosives like HDX or RDX used as well. FEMA talks about the sulfidation. This is in the FEMA report. I'm sorry. It's this Professor Barnett again. He's a good guy out in Massachusetts. Said, look, we found this steel under Building 7, and it's got sulfidation. It means sulfur attacked the steel, which it does. Where'd the sulfur come from? Good question. Used in conjunction with thermite, it's called thermate. It's a military form, and it's used to cut through steel rapidly. Hot spots in the rubble corroborate the reports of the deep down molten metal. This is, let me just say, this is, FG is building the south tower, and then the north tower is, north tower is the CD right here, in this area, the red color, and then this is building 7. The red orange implies these very high temperatures. This is 5 days after 9/11. Okay, I'm going to have to skip this. Well, I'll read a little bit. There is an explosion at the base of the building. This is building 2. White smoke from the bottom. White smoke, again, consistent with thermite. Something happened. See, what you do is you want to cut those core columns, these huge steel cores, down low. And this is what the demolition expert said. If I were going to bring the towers down, I would put explosives in the basement to get the weight of the building to help collapse the structure. Gosh, that sounds just like what happened, particularly at Building 7. But, the tower is also, there are reports of explosions. Now we get to a little thing that's kind of important, a puzzle piece. I brought along puzzle, which my wife dug up for me. We're putting out these puzzle pieces, molten metal at the bottom of the both towers and Building 7, and it rusty when you look at the slag. The collapse of Building 7, straight down, the rapid collapse of Building 7, the fact that the fires were not hot enough, we're trying to put these pieces together and figure it out. Here's another one of these puzzle pieces. In building 7 was the CIA's undercover New York station. And also offices of the Department of Defense and FBI. Now, this is a high security building. It's not like you can have hijackers running in there. It's cordoned off on 9/11 and start planning explosives that day. No, or the towers either, of course. And this is a particularly high security building. Now, here's another puzzle piece, which I think will interest you. Down at the bottom here, I mentioned this briefly. The towers were old and loaded with asbestos. There was much discussion of how we're going to get this asbestos out of the towers or take the towers down. It was prohibitively expensive. The owner / leaseholder of these buildings insured these buildings, the World Trade Center buildings, against terrorist attack less than 2 months before 9/11. I'm not, sure, but he did receive an estimated over $4 billion in insurance payment. Now, the cleanup was out of our money, taxpayers. The building of these buildings, it looks like, will be largely funded by taxpayers' money. This guy has pocketed a fair piece of change. And I would ask a few questions, if I were in a position to do so. I am asking the questions. I just thought I'm not in a position to get answers under oath. Okay, anyway, it takes weeks to plan. You should know that. Not a lot of explosives, 3,000 pounds per building, but it takes weeks to plan to bring a building down like this and to plant explosives to get a building to come down in this way. Who could pull it off with the CIA, FBI, and DOD in the highly secure building? So questions naturally arise whether this was an inside job. It doesn't look like the hijackers brought the buildings down. That's what I said in my original paper. And that's just science. I mean, it's just almost inescapable. I don't see any way out of it. Scott Forbes wrote that on the weekend just prior to 9/11, there was a power down condition in Tower 2, the South Tower, for approximately 36 hours. Ben Fountain says, over the past few weeks, we've been evacuated a number of times from the World Trade Center South Tower, which is unusual. I think they had an inkling that something was going on. I suspect he's right. Anyway, that's what he thought. Okay, let's move right along. And I've quoted some of these. I'm sorry, I don't know if there's anything here. It's too new. MIT professor, though, wrote me, I agree wholeheartedly with one comment, you talk about my paper, that the official inquiries are grossly inadequate and the conclusion may well be wrong. Building engineers, he says, are on the defensive. Okay, the toxic dust is next. Deep breath. Immediately following the tragedy, scientists analyzed the dust samples, and I have some dust here that was given to me by a woman from her apartment in New York City. And it's loaded with asbestos, the dust, heavy metals, mercury in particular, from all the fluorescent lights in those buildings, it's loaded with mercury, and a very high alkalinity. Now, let's see what that means. One of the scientists, Greg Swayze, says, tests revealed the dust to be extremely alkaline, a pH of 12, and that some of it was as caustic as liquid drain cleaner. We were startled at the pH level we were finding. We knew it was caustic, but we were getting pH readings of 12 and higher. It was obvious that precautions had to be taken to protect the workers and people from this dust. Of course, this information was sent right quickly to the Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, and other health services. Now, what happened? Here we see a report by Internal Inspector, EPA Inspector General Nikki Tinsley. Here's what happened. I'm just going to read this. It was in the newspapers. You might have seen it. This is from a Seattle Post-Intelligencer report. At the White House's direction, the EPA gave New Yorkers misleading assurances that there was no health risk from the debris-laden air after the World Trade Center collapse, according to an internal inquiry. The White House, quote, and this is quoting from Tinsley's report, convinced EPA to add reassuring statements and delete cautionary ones. Now, folks, this makes me upset a bit. When Leslie said, don't get, as a scientist, to see politicians take perfectly good scientific data. This is very hazardous, toxic stuff. We've got precautions. And to flip that upside down and say it's safe, that is just wrong. It's unethical. And it is, I can't call it anything else, but, okay, I'll use the scientific term, data falsification. Okay, that's the scientific term. However, what they explained was that at that time, all statements to the media should be cleared first by the National Security Council, which is Bush's main forum for matters. Senior aides in his cabinet are on this council. I'd like to know who pushed for this data falsification. A little more. The EPA Inspector General found the EPA was persuaded to omit guidance for cleaning. See, originally the EPA had a statement saying, well, here's what you have to do. It's dangerous stuff. Guidance for cleaning spaces, tips on potential health effects from this dust, which contains asbestos, lead, glass fibers. You can see the chips of glass, even in that lady's apartment, in this stuff. I mean, it's not like you want to touch this stuff or breathe it. They're, oh, what did they actually say? Oh, yes. Not quite yet. Okay, so there have been people now who've died. You may have noticed this. It was just a few weeks ago now. This is in the news again. A man, a police officer who helped clean up, retired. He developed black lung disease, expected from the toxicity and caustic nature of the dust, and mercury on the brain. And mercury is mercury in the dust. Now, that combination says very clearly, this is the dust, and he's there breathing this. He worked, 470 hours in the first month helping people, rescue and recovery. He gave his life to help people, and he was told it was safe. Some of these rescue workers were asked not to wear dust masks because it might frighten people. This is not nice. I mean, this is very bad stuff. A majority of residents and Ground Zero workers have reported worsening respiratory problems in the years since the attacks. Tim Keller died also at the age of 41, clearly because of this dust. It's actually difficult to say for sure in some of these cases. You know, these people have respiratory problems. So, but I mean, you've got black lung disease and mercury on the brain, and you worked for many hours. I mean, come on, it's pretty clear. What do we have to do to prove it to you? This is bad stuff, and they shouldn't have said it's safe. So here's where they're saying it's safe. I'm quoting from the EPA press releases directly, and this is the ones that went out to the public, not the initial one that's had cautionary warnings, but the ones that went to the public. And again, what was it? 5 times in 10 days after 9/11, saying this is safe. Our tests show that it is safe for New Yorkers to go back to work in New York Financial District. This was obviously one of the prime concerns of politicians. We want to get the financial district going again. EPA Administrator Christy Whitman, who has since resigned, announced that the results, air and drinking water monitoring, indicate these vital resources are safe. And then we have a scientist, though, and I'm proud of this man, Thomas Cahill, UC Davis, said, look, we felt based on the measurements that we had made a mile away from the site that the materials coming off of the hot collapse pile, there's again that heat, were much more dangerous, in fact, than we had been generally led to believe. Yes, much more dangerous. It's certainly not safe. And, of course, they've been hit with a lawsuit for unnecessarily people unnecessarily exposed to potentially hazardous levels of asbestos and other carcinogens and toxic substances. The lawsuit accuses EPA of a shockingly deliberate indifference to human health. Again, that bothers me. I don't like it when they falsify data. I'm trying not to say lie. Okay. I'm trying to say data falsification. Okay. Why? Because, I don't know, people don't like it when you say the government lied to you. This is data falsification. It was very dangerous stuff. Yes, Leslie, I'll try not to get too passionate about this. Okay. I asked students about this. We have a class. We're talking about science and ethics, obviously. This is a topic that I raised to them. Yeah, because it's an ethical question and relates to science as well. Here's what the students responded to me. I haven't sent me emails. The public should definitely have been warned about the dust, but what would happen if they were? This could have caused a major impediment in the rebound of the economy. Very practical person. I guess it's just a question of what is more important to those in authority. I think the student hit it on the head there. What is more important, you see? To those in authority. Is it right to sacrifice some lives for the national good? A student asks. In this context, my point of view is that honesty is the best thing for the people. Losing lives due to the toxic dust can be thought of as a propagation of the terrorist act. That's an interesting point of view. And here's the student last at the bottom here. I've been thinking a lot about this, she wrote. Excuse me. Our political leaders basically have our lives in their hands. I've been paying more attention to the news, and I think that I will actually take the time to vote next time. Yes, yes. Okay, that's good. Pay attention to the news, and do your own research, too. Go a little deeper than just what you get in these news releases, and then vote. Yeah. I had other people rationalize. One told me, she was adamant, there was no asbestos. Hint, there was, okay? I mean, there's no question. She wouldn't yield on that point. It must be safe because there's no asbestos. Now, another one I hit. If the administration said this dust was safe, it's okay. Only liberals or Democrats would complain. Okay. Look, these issues transcend party politics. I'm not talking about Democrat, Republican, whatever. I'm talking about people's lives here. Okay? It was unethical to deceive people in this way, but surely it was an isolated case. I wish that were so. It's not an isolated case. Okay, now here's a question. This is down here. These neoconservatives, some of you have heard about them. We'll quote them a little more later. One of their leaders said, in order, this is in his book that he published, and I've got the title of the book here. In order to achieve the most noble achievements, I don't agree with this guy. I mean, the leader may have to enter into evil. This is the chilling insight that has made Machiavelli so feared, admired, and challenging. I don't admire this thought at all. Paul says it's wrong. You can look in Romans. Paul talks about overcoming evil with good. Jesus talks about doing good, that good may come. We don't do evil, that good may come. It is... Where do you stop if you take that philosophy? Yeah? Where do you draw the line? I'm sorry, I'm getting passionate again. It just annoys me. Okay. I agree with Paul. We stay on the Lord's side of the line and we do good, whether we believe in God or not. We know we don't lie to people and hurt them. Now, bin Laden was blamed. This is interesting, I think. So, here's some pictures. Another one of these. You know, Sesame Street, which one of these is not like the other? Okay, yeah. And there's five, and I put one more in here. So let's sing out, which, as you look at these, you've seen bin Laden through the years. I mean, we've all seen him, I'm sure. Which one of these just does not look like your bin Laden? Sing out the number, letter?
E.
E. Okay, good. Okay, now we did some analysis. I work with a student on this because it looks pretty obvious, but if you do some detailed work on it, we looked at the length of the nose and nose to the width. We looked at the nose-ear distance as well. This guy's ear is tilted quite a bit. The picture is not real clear, unfortunately, from this, but it's clear enough. This ratio is about half of Al Jazeera's. This is the Osama bin Laden released by the Pentagon and the Bush administration in December. Now, I don't know why more people didn't say, wait a minute, that's not bin Laden. But here's what bin Laden himself said 5 days and then, 17 days after 9/11. He said, I stress that I have not carried out this act. This is a videotape now. And Al Jazeera, yes, and this is the fellow, the one that we're all familiar with, which appears to have been carried out by individuals with their own motivation. Then on the 28th of September, just 17 days after 9/11, I have already said I am not involved in the 11 September attacks in the United States. As a Muslim, I try my best to avoid telling a lie. Now, I'm not saying he's a good man, but I'm just saying, let's give him a chance, okay? And see, why do we all think that he's responsible? Did you know that he denied this? See, what happened was the U.S. administration urged American media not to broadcast these words because they're saying perhaps he's giving signals to the cells of terrorists that are still in the United States, which is possible. Yeah. But as you actually look what he says, he is denying that he was involved. He says at the bottom, the United States should trace the perpetrators of these attacks to those persons who want to make the present century a century of conflict between Islam and Christianity so that their own nation could survive. That's quite a statement, but I'm not saying it's right either, but it's something to think about. Now, this is the, again, the bin Laden from the so-called smoking gun video. And it's true that he does say that he was, this guy is, that he calculated the number of casualties from the enemy who would be killed based on the position of the tower. I mean, he's clearly talking about that. Now, let me just move along quickly on this. I asked a bin Laden expert, Duke University professor Bruce Lawrence, if this was bin Laden. He replied emphatically, this is not bin Laden. And he went on to tell me in his email, just within the last couple of weeks, he doubts that the bin Laden tape, you remember the one aired in January? He said, again, that doesn't sound like bin Laden. But that was an audio tape. This is video, and we can clearly rule out bin Laden. And this is after the release of the so-called confession tape. He says, again, you know, the United States now has attacked Afghanistan and killed many people. They are innocent, but on a mere suspicion, the United States has launched this fierce campaign. We have witnessed the true crimes of those who call themselves... I mean, should I not give this guy a chance to speak? I think I should. Okay. We have witnessed the true crimes of those, thank you, of those who call themselves humanitarians and claim to be defenders of freedom. Certainly not for these people who died. Now, here's what the Muslims did say. They said, this does not look like bin Laden to us. And this is the tape released Thursday. This is back in December of 2001. By the Bush administration. What happened was, as our soldiers went into Afghanistan, and then they found this tape in a large city. So I guess they were looking at a lot of videotapes, but they found this one. And immediately they said, this was bin Laden. The Muslims tended not to agree. They say it's not a proven fact, still not a proven case that he directed it, this 9/11 attack, that he planned it or funded it. Now, Mira Giuliani, regarding this tape, said that it showed bin Laden was the personification of evil. President Bush became aware of these doubts and suspicions, and mostly in the Muslim world, and he said it is preposterous for anybody to think that this tape is doctored. That's just a feeble excuse to provide weak support for an incredibly evil man. Well, my own conclusion is that this is not bin Laden. And I'm not sure then what this is a smoking gun confession tape, but it's not him. Now, this is what's happened then is that bin Laden was convicted on TV. The question is, what other suspects were even investigated? The evidence from the crime scene, as we've seen, was destroyed as the steel beams were cut up and shipped quickly away. The dust was declared safe. Surveillance videos and flight recorders have been seized and not released to the public. I'm talking here about the surveillance videos at the Pentagon in particular. They released 5 frames, which don't show a jet going into the Pentagon at all. It's very suspicious. And so, again, if I were to talk about good science, we start with the facts and draw conclusions. Bad science is we start with the conclusion. I wrote it here. I put this on myself. Muslims did it. And then we look for facts or whatever we can find to support it. That's bad science. You start with we start with the data, okay? And then we build our conclusions. That's what I'm trying to do here, to lead to conclusions anyway. So what happened? The U.S. immediately attacked and occupied Afghanistan to kill al-Qaeda, as they said, and to get bin Laden. Oddly, bin Laden is apparently still on the loose. Al-Qaeda is growing throughout the world. and very rapidly. In fact, there was editorial by Paul Roberts, Dr. Roberts, who worked in the Reagan administration. He's very concerned about all this. He's emailed me and agrees that there's something very wrong in the official story of 9/11. He said that 95% of the terrorists have developed. I mean, the Muslims are angry for some reason for us attacking their country. They feel it was without being attacked. They say, Iraq didn't attack the United States. What are you doing? Iraqis are saying that we're defending ourselves. Anyway, 95% of the terrorists have grown since then, built up since our attacks on Afghanistan. And I noticed in a U.S. News and World Report, the opium trade in Afghanistan has taken off too. Tripled, you say. Why is that? We got our military. We control the country. Why are we allowing this opium trade? Big business, I suppose, but people are more important than business. I think that's true. Okay. But anyway, I don't know all the details, but there are some questions there. Now, this is an admission by FBI Director Robert Mueller. The hijackers left no paper trail. In our investigation, we have not uncovered a single piece of paper either here in the U.S. or in the treasure trove of information that's turned up in Afghanistan or elsewhere. Not a single piece of paper that mentioned any aspect of the September 11th plot. Basically, all they had is this so-called confession tape, which isn't even bin Laden. There are many questions about that tape, by the way. It doesn't ring true to the Muslim religion, the statements made there. Okay, that finishes bin Laden. Now the hardest part, and we still have some time. Yes. Did officials know about the impending attacks in advance? And then I'll talk about the United States Constitution. So here we have evidence, not proof, and I made that clear. You may have seen the letter to the editor in Deseret News that was published this morning, in which I said, we have questions about this. The Scholars for 9/11 Truth group is pursuing these questions. We have evidence that there was foreknowledge, that is, before 9/11, that officials in our government knew that there were impending attacks, but did not stop them. But we don't have proof. We have just evidence, and I'll show you some of that evidence. But I'm going to back up now a timeline going way back to September 2000. So this is just before President Bush was elected, which was in November of 2000. A group of men, and it's going to be, okay, I'll just try to give you as much as I can here, short time. A group put together a document, and it's available now on the web that you can read, and I've read a fair amount of it, in which they, and these are the people involved. You recognize some of this. Vice President Cheney, Paul Wolfowitz, who was Assistant Secretary of Defense with Don Rumsfeld, is also on this. Richard Pearl. Louis Libby was recently indicted. Jeb Bush is the brother of President Bush. And that's Michael Ledeen, the guy who said we have to enter into evil to achieve noble, etc. Okay. The United States, and now just from the document, which you can read, the United States has for decades sought to play a more permanent role in the Gulf. I'm talking about the Persian Gulf, Iraq, and so on. While the unresolved conflict with Iraq, this is 2000 now, they're saying the conflict there is unresolved, provides the immediate justification, the need for a substantial American force presence in the Gulf transcends the issue of the regime of Saddam Hussein. And they're itching to get United States military into Iraq back then. The process of transformation, you have to read this document. They're talking about a transformation of war. It's essentially, and they call it, well, they mentioned it's a revolutionary change in American society. They want it to be more militaristic, and I think that's just a good summary of what they're talking about. Much more money for the military thereafter. It is likely to be a long one unless or absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor. And that's a little bit chilling that they should say, this is what we need to get this process going, or that at least that would do it. Yeah. So here's some more. I just quoted what they're after. Personnel strength, increase defense spending dramatically, reposition U.S. forces, Iraq is specified, defend the American homeland, which is now called the Homeland Security, control the new international commons of space and cyberspace. You know about our program to send missiles and so on, but cyberspace is not yet under control. Okay, exploit the revolution in military affairs and American global leadership. Some of this sounds okay, except when you say the global security order that is uniquely friendly to American prosperity. Now, I don't read that in the Constitution, that we should have some kind of global security order that is uniquely friendly to ourselves. The term my friend Professor David Griffin uses for this is American empire. That's what it sounds like. You agree, David? It's a little scary. The Constitution does not say we can establish a global security order to maintain American prosperity, which is what this document calls for. The military's job during the Cold War was to deter Soviet expansionism. Today, its task is to secure and expand zones of democratic peace. Does that sound familiar? To deter the rise of any power competitor and to preserve American preeminence through the coming transformation of war. Now, you notice these guys, how often they talk about a transformation. What are they talking about? Revolutionary change in American society. I'm saying, whoa, what happened on 9/11? It was a revolutionary change, but I'm not sure I like it. I'm not sure it's ethical. I'm not sure it's right to use preemptive war, which followed from that. The process of transformation, since it brings revolutionary change, is likely to be a long one, absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event. I sure hope we don't need another one of those. But here's what President Bush, and this is reported, reporters learned this, on the night of 9/11, he wrote, "The Pearl Harbor of the 21st century took place today." Now, that connection isn't necessarily strong, but I think we'd all agree that that was like Pearl Harbor, getting us into war and to other changes. I've already talked about most of this. Who these neoconservatives, these men are called neoconservatives, but they call themselves that, and they're now in the administration. Richard Armitage, Bill Bennett, Jeb Bush, Ellen Bork, Dick Cheney, Kala Zod, Louis Libby, of course, indicted, Richard Pearl, Don Rumsfeld, and Paul Wolfowitz, who's now the president of the World Bank, appointed by President Bush. And to me, this is information we need to know. More puzzle pieces. I wish it wasn't so that they had this plan and we're seeing it coming out, but folks, we can read about this plan. We can stop it if we want to. If you want to have American empire, then you can continue to support this group. They're called neoconservatives. Now, this is Secretary O'Neill, who was fired later, but he's writing a book about his experiences in the Bush administration. At the first meeting, this is again the National Security Council we talked about before. This is Bush's department heads and closest advisors. And from a CBS News report, but it's in his book, Paul O'Neill, I think is a very honest man, The Price of Loyalty, he calls it. He was fired, but he said, from the very first instance, it was about Iraq. Now, this is back then in January of 2001. This is before, of course, 9/11 by 9 months or so. Day one, it was about what we can do to change this regime. Saddam Hussein. Day one, these things were laid and sealed. Did you know that? They're talking about how are we going to get into Iraq. The president was saying, go find me a way to do this. And then O'Neill comments, for me, the notion of preemption, attacking a country without having been attacked first, in order because they may have weapons of mass destruction and so on, you know, before, they didn't, it turned out, but that the U.S. has a unilateral right to do whatever we decide to do is a really huge leap, And it's an enormous change of policy. It's called the Bush Doctrine. It was enunciated, was at West Point, after 9/11, before we attacked Iraq, this policy of preemptive war. Is this a fact? I mean, preemption, and you can just look up Bush Doctrine, Google on that. You'll learn a lot about the preemptive war doctrine that O'Neill is complaining about. Also in this CBS News report, they talk about Susskind, who says there was a plan for a post-Saddam Iraq. Now, this is way back before 9/11. They discussed an occupation of Iraq in January and February of 2001. These are painful truths to me. I've been a lifelong Republican, but I don't associate with that party at this time. Or any party, tell you the truth. I'm looking for facts. And for someone who'll support the Constitution, we'll see. But anyway, they discussed an occupation of Iraq in January and February of 2001. The planning envisioned peacekeeping troops. We have those in Iraq. War crime tribunals. We have those in Iraq. And even divvying up Iraq's oil wealth was discussed. Interesting. We haven't done that. That's not a popular thing to talk about. this is a quote that I just struck me, and I put it in here also. Dick Cheney famously said, deficits don't matter. I'm sure many of you heard that at a cabinet meeting. Secretary O'Neill objected to that. He said, they do matter. We can't just keep ballooning our national debt, which has grown by about 30% in the last 4 years, one-third. But Cheney said, we won the 2002 midterms. This is our due. I don't know if you've noticed how the national debt's explained. I worry about it. Forewarning. There are reports in foreign newspapers, not a lot of this, and BBC broadcasting. U.S. officials were warned of imminent major attacks by terrorists, especially during the summer of 2001. This is before 9/11, by Britain, Egypt, France, Germany, Israel, Italy, and so on. There were names of four of the terrorists. I don't recognize all of these, but I do recognize Mohammed Atta, who was one of the principal hijackers. Anyone tell me which tower he flew into? I'm not sure. South Tower, I think. North? Oh, North Tower. We got a consensus. He didn't survive. His passport was found, yes. Okay, another question. But so this came out, of course, after 9/11, the fact that these warnings were given to the United States government. And Jane's Intelligence Digest says, it is rather strange that the U.S. media seems to be ignoring what may well be the most explosive story since the 11 September attacks, the foreknowledge. Well, there's a lot of explosive stories, including explosions, you know, that were heard by many people, but as you see the squibs and so on. Kurt Weldon, now I support Kurt Weldon. He's a Republican out of Pennsylvania. He is pursuing this question of the foreknowledge by the government of Mohammed Atta. And the intelligence operation which pursued Atta is called Able Danger. You may have heard of that. And Kurt Weldon is spearheading this investigation. And here's what he says as he rises last summer. I rise because information has come to my attention over the past several months that is very disturbing. I have learned that, in fact, one of our federal agents had, in fact, identified the major New York cell of Mohammed Atta prior to 9/11. And anyway, we'll go on. There's an editorial about this. And now here's a man, I think, who respects the Constitution, Representative Kurt Weldon, Pennsylvania. To his credit, he's pursuing this. An editorial about this, which was in the Wall Street Journal, says, and I'm just quoting now from the editorial. The final 9/11 Commission report, released in July of 2004, concluded that American intelligence agencies were unaware of Mr. Atta until the day of the attacks. This now looks to be embarrassingly wrong. Even the most junior investigator would immediately know the name and photo ID of Atta in 2000 is precisely the kind of intelligence the FBI has many times employed to prevent attacks. Yet the 9/11 Commission inexplicably concluded it was not historically significant. This astounding conclusion. See, these words that people use, like, what is going on here? How could they make a conclusion like that? And later, initially, the 9/11 Commission people said, well, we didn't know. And then later they said, well, yeah, we did, but we didn't think it was that important. Gosh, it's very important. This astounding conclusion, in combination with the failure to investigate Able Danger and incorporate it into the findings of the commission, raises serious challenges to the commission's credibility. There's a book about the 9/11 Commission by David Griffin, which I recommend, which I've got, and I've read a lot of it, which challenges more than just this oversight. And 9/11 families, of course, are concerned about this. One woman says, I'm angry that my son's death could have been prevented. Now, this is a fairly serious, is a very serious thing. It needs to be pursued. And I support Representative Weldon in his investigation. Here's some more. It's September 10th, the day before. Just a number of things happened that could be coincidences, but it could be there was foreknowledge. Newsweek reported, on September 10th, Newsweek has learned, a group of top Pentagon officials suddenly canceled travel plans for the next morning, apparently because of security concerns. On September 10th, Donald Rumsfeld admitted at a press conference that over $2 trillion in Pentagon funds could not be accounted for. Quoting Rumsfeld, according to some estimates, we cannot track $2.3 trillion in transactions. Ordinarily, you'd get some interest out of that soon. But on the 11th, the next day, the course was this tragedy, and all of this was essentially, as it says, forgotten, all but forgotten. And some of this has been found, but apparently not all of it. There's still hundreds of billions, I understand, missing. Nobody seems to be worried about. The day of September 11th, that evening, Rumsfeld went to Congress, asked for more money for the military to fight terror, and then, of course, the money was soon allocated. In fulfillment, remember, of this strategy, this roadmap of the neoconservatives, that we need to have more money for the military and beef up our, in fact, have a transformation in society. Okay, this is interesting. I'm just going to summarize. In fact, I'll quote this one involved. FEMA was Johnny on the spot on 9/11. How did that happen? Remember, after Katrina, they were slow. But on 9/11, they were right there. In fact, they were there the day before. As that's true. And it was admitted by Mayor Giuliani. He says, on September 12th, this pier was going to have a drill. So the people gathered on the 10th, you see, and this guy was one of the drill. We arrived late Monday night on the 10th and, of course, went into action on the 11th. It had hundreds of people here from FEMA and so on. They were ready for a drill on the 12th, but they came in. Of course, the equipment was already there also on the 10th. Now, that to me is a bit suspicious. In Manhattan, folks, downtown New York, we're not talking about, you know, some, I mean, the drill was at the right time in the right place the day before. The match is about to begin. This is a bit of intelligence that leaked out of the Senate Intelligence Committee. It was a communication to Mohammed Atta, and the message stated, the match is about to begin. This was, again, on the 10th. A woman would like to know, who's the message from, right? And why don't we know more about it? The Rupert has written a book which details a lot of these issues that indicate foreknowledge. But when this intelligence came out, the White House was infuriated. He says, or his Michael Caine, who's a partner of Rupert, the intelligence committee had released this bit of information. They were threatened with polygraphs and office searches for disclosing classified information. It seems to be what was the recent one? Wiretapping, domestic wiretapping. So what do? Apologize? No. We try to find out and punish the person. And Nikki Tinsley, the one who said the dust was toxic, she was also criticized for her report by the administration. We're getting almost done. Lack of air defenses on this day. This is an important point, and it bears scientific analysis. There's a lot of data here. Building 1, World Trade Center 1, crashed. That is, the plane crashed into it at 8:46. We knew we were under attack at that time. At 8:46, it's coincidentally the same time, American Airlines 77 was taken over. You know that because it goes wildly off course at that time. 8:40, what does that say? 8:46, yeah, right here. Now, FAA tracks planes, and when they go wildly off course like that, the typical response is to scramble military escorts. Doesn't mean you're going to shoot it down. No, it's a graduated response. It means you try to get the plane to land if it looks like it's hijacked. And, of course, the transponders are off, transponders. So you know that this plane is not, it really looks hijacked, okay? It's not just off course. But even off course, the military routinely scrambles. In the year before 9/11, 67 times. Near D.C., it only takes about 5 minutes to scramble a jet because, as you see, there are two Air Force bases right near north and south of Washington, D.C. So we're talking 5 minutes. Now, the takeover was 8:46. 52 minutes later is the collision of the plane and the Pentagon or something. I'll just leave it at that. At 52 minutes, where were our air defenses? Now, this is a very important question. It just takes minutes. We routinely scramble aircraft. Where were our defenses that day? This concerns me deeply. The 9/11 Commission report deals with this. Of course, they can't ignore it. Washington Post says, here's how they handled it. Portray a discombobulated government that can't even keep track of the hijacked planes. Fighter planes flying in the wrong directions. Pilots have no idea why they're in the air. Well, that may be, but I'm afraid there's a little more to it than that. I'm not going to listen to the video from her. We will skip some of this. Let me read, though, what people say. Generally, it's impossible to carry out an act of terror on the scenario which was used in the USA yesterday. It's a Russian Air Force commander. As soon as something like that happens here, I'm reported about that right away, and in a minute, we are all up. Well, that used to happen in the United States, but not on September 11th, and I'd like to know why. Okay, Secretary Mineta, in his testimony to the 9/11 Commission, I'm quoting it here in yellow. So, the Commission's saying, well, let's see what happened on 9/11. That's their job. Good. Mineta says this. Let's read it and think about it, please. During the time that the airplane was coming into the Pentagon, there was a young man who would come in and say to the vice president, now, the scene is we're under the White House in a bunker. The president is flying because he'd been in Florida, and he's not back in Washington till about 7 p.m. that evening, the 11th. So the vice president's in charge down there. Secretary Mineta is there, and he reports what he observed. A young man would come in and say to the vice president, the plane is 50 miles out. Plenty of time, folks, to scramble a jet. Next, the plane is 30 miles out. When it came to the plane is 10 miles out, the young man also said to the vice president, do the orders still stand? The vice president turned and whipped his neck around and said, of course, The orders still stand. Have you heard anything to the contrary? Now, my question would be, what orders? Ramsey, there's plenty of time to shoot the plane down. The plane was not shut down, it didn't have to be shot down. It could have been forced down. Okay, we don't have to. This is a common misperception that when you scramble a jet, you're going to shoot the plane down. No. This 67 times in the year prior, not one of those was shot down. Okay, so you escort the plane, you try to get it to land. I mean, shooting down is absolutely the last recourse, of course. In this case, there's plenty of time to scramble a jet. There was no jet scramble. The plane was not intercepted, and it crashed into the Pentagon, killing many people, including a Latter-day Saint. I read in the Deseret News a woman in the Pentagon when this plane hit then. Where were our air defenses? And what are these orders? And why didn't the commission ask about these orders? You know, Mineta's testimony, he seems like an honest man to talk about this. His testimony was not even included in the 9/11 commission report. I'd like to know what is going on. Flight recorders. This fellow, Nicholas DeMasi, firefighter, worked with federal agents. We loaded up about $1 million of equipment. There were a total of 4 black boxes. We found 3. According to the government, 0 were found. This is in the towers. See, we want to know what's happening on the flights, what's really happening. So that's just another puzzle piece. I don't know if that's as important as what those orders were. Here's another puzzle piece. President Bush was in Florida at an elementary school during the attacks, reading a book about goats with the children. And we'd already had an attack. Remember, it's 8:46. And he told a reporter he'd heard about the attacks, but he goes ahead and heads to the school. He said,
I was sitting there, and my chief of staff, well, first of all, when we walked in the classroom, I had seen this plane fly into the first building. There was a TV set on, and I thought it was pilot error. And I was amazed anybody could make such a terrible mistake. And something was wrong with the plane.
But you know, this is the first tower now, and that was a private person, and that was not shown on TV. People didn't even know that this private person had captured that first plane hitting the tower. It was not shown for, I think it was 3 or 4 hours after the first tower had been hit. And then this person came forth with his video evidence. It was long after. So this is puzzling. Maybe he made a mistake there. Andrew Card came in at 9:02 and whispered in Bush's ear. And he said, America is under attack. This is now the second tower being hit. And Bush continues to sit there for another 20 minutes or so, about 20 minutes, until about 9:25. Now, my main question is, I mean, I can understand this is shocking, and he might not have known what to do, but where were his handlers, the security agents of Bush? He's in a public place. We're under attack. He's in danger, and the children are in danger. Let's get him out of there. 20 minutes, he sits there. This is puzzling and disturbing in the sense that it's unexplained. I don't know how to explain it unless they knew beforehand, but maybe not. Yeah, there are some questions there, certainly. These are the puzzle pieces. There are many more, some of which are in our papers. And finally, I'd like to point out the United States Constitution provides for defense, not wars of aggression, when we haven't even been attacked by Iraq. And the core principles of the Constitution are limited, balanced government, reserving powers and rights to the states and the people. Protection of inalienable rights are given by God, not the government. This is just a recent editorial. Paul Roberts worked under President Reagan. He's very concerned about what is happening in the current administration. He was a good Republican. I understand, work with Reagan. I really respect President Reagan. why does any American think that spying, in many ways, spying without a warrant has any more effect in reducing the threat of terrorism than spying with a warrant? Do you know we have, the law says you, it's in yellow, the law permits the president to spy first for 72 hours, 3 days, and then come to the court afterwards for permission. So there's really no excuse not to have a warrant. You can get it after the fact. President Bush has said he's not going to do that. Many people are saying that's against the law. I'm wondering, why not do it legally? Yeah, the law allows this, and who's being spied on? And then I want to point this out, too. Americans need to desperately to understand that 95% of all Muslim terrorists in the world were created in the past 3 years by Bush's invasion of Iraq. I mean, where's another point? Oh, yes, here. Prior to Bush's invasion of Iraq, a large majority of Muslims had a favorable opinion of America. Now only about 5% have a favorable opinion. This is sad. Why are we doing this? So, Constitution provides for a common defense. I think we need to question wars of aggression. I've noticed that there is sword rattling relative to Iran lately. Fox seems to be giving various reasons for this. But I don't think that we should attack Iran if they haven't attacked us. I don't believe in preemptive war. I believe this is a very dangerous and oppressive policy. It's contrary to international law. It was never the policy of the United States until the Bush Doctrine, which was, enunciated in 2002. Well, actually, you find it in the neoconservatives' writings before that. They wanted this preemptive war. We've got it. I think it's illegal. We need to get back to the rule of the Constitution and law. No one should break the law with impunity, including warrantless wiretapping. We have law. It allows you 72 hours to get permission. Torture. I can't understand why Vice President Cheney and the President were wanting the CIA to be able to have torture. Do we have secret prisons in Eastern Europe? Why are we talking about these things? I'm saying, whoa. What is going on? I guess there's no proof yet, but it saddens me that we've strayed so far from the Constitution, evidently. There are three branches of government, not one or two. The legislative branch is charged with declaring war, not the president. The oversight investigations also are the responsibility of Congress, and I hope they will get doing it. Thank you.